Welcome back to the news today. The last few months in the Israeli society maybe are what we are all experiencing is some kind of a deterioration in the behavior or what is happening to the Israeli society. Our correspondents here in I-24 News during all these months captured and were reporting about the recent situation. And I brought them here today to speak about their own experience about what is happening inside Israel and with the neighbors that we have here in the region. And with me tonight are Ayman Siksik, good evening.
Good evening, Lisa.
Shai Ben-Ari, good evening.
Good evening,
Lisa. And Rachel Pellet, good evening.
Good evening.
You know, just like to do a small summarizing about what happened last few weeks. The gay pride parade attack, the burning of church, the burning of the baby, the burning of Mohammed Abu Khdir, the war, Operation Protective Edge, the extremism that we are experiencing in the Israeli society. And from your own perspective, you are reporting on this each and every day. How do you feel about this? Because we are all part of the Israeli society and we are seeing what is happening. And there is a big red sign that it seems that maybe in the government, maybe the Israeli government is not paying good or great attention to a Chacham.
Lucy, I think we hear the headline Third Intifada so many times over the recent years, but I feel there's a sort of indifference coming from the normal, sane voice within the Israeli society. People are fed up. They feel that going out and demonstrating is not enough anymore, whether it's because of the cost of living, the gas prices, or discrimination and violence. They feel that going out to the streets and trying to make some kind of change and bring about a change isn't helping anymore, and this creates some kind of frustration that there's no way to expose it or say anything that would create some kind of change, and this is growing more and more frustrating among the sane voices whom we see going abroad, leaving the country, closing themselves in their homes, writing a bit on Facebook, but not actually creating a change. And I think this is one of the great dangers.
In a society that is relied, the Israeli society is, let's say, this is the army of the people. It's relied on security. Every single thing, every aspect, we're examining it from the security point of view because Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East. Israel has a lot of enemies around it. And it seems that this is the excuse for everything. Because people wants to, are the enemies outside, wants to kill or demolish Israel, it seems like it's a good excuse for the Israeli society, or let's say not the majority, but maybe a minority in the Israeli society, to say what it wants and to act how it wants.
Certainly security and you know, the notion of security justifying all sorts of measures taken by the government, that's a dangerous, slippery slope. And these questions come into focus lots of times in Israel, especially when you talk about stuff that has been in the headlines recently. For example, administrative detention. These are the kinds of questions that Israeli society has to face all the time. How often can you use these measures, which are, at the end of the day, very extreme, to put someone in detention with no trial for an undefined period of time? We're now seeing that it's actually being used against people who can be defined as Jewish terrorists. This has been used before. It's not the first time. Usually it is used against Arab suspects. And these are the kinds of debates that Israeli society is reminded of every once in a while.
The death penalty to terrorists?
Right. It's being raised now, but it's not the first time. You can't escape the notion of some sort of deja vu. You know, we always find ourselves in the same situations again and again, even the stabbing at the gay pride parade, that has happened before. It's the same individual who did it before.
I want to look with you, Ayman, about the situation of the Israeli Arab society here. You are an Israeli Arab. You're experiencing this from all kind of aspects, as a journalist, as an author, as a citizen in the state of Israel. In the last few years, there is something different. There is a feeling that is going to the extreme lack of tolerance between the two sides, between the Jewish side and the Arab side inside Israel, is just even getting to, let's say, levels that I don't remember it. I don't remember it growing up like that.
Well, we've seen it certainly during Operation Protective Edge when there were marches. For the first time, I think, that I can remember in my lifetime, in Jerusalem calling death to Arabs, we didn't hear any official condemnation of this. But this, for me, I think, as an Arab citizen of Israel, this started way before, around the year 2000 in the October riots, when for the first time, when Palestinians inside Israel identified with what was going on, in the Gaza Strip, there were clashes between Israeli police and Arab citizens of Israel. I think this was the first point where relations between Arab Israelis and the state authorities broke for the first time. And in an ironic way, Israel has since, as a state, pushed Palestinians within Israel or Arab citizens of Israel to identify more with their Palestinian heritage because they feel estranged from the Israeli state.
You know, I wanted to take you to the social media part of it because the social media played a big role in what is happening all around the world and specifically what is happening here in Israel. And seeing the campaign in the last few weeks of Jewish adding death to Arabs to their names and Arabs adding death to Jews to their names on Facebook. This is another phenomena that is actually, again, just steaming up the entire situation.
And there's no anonymity anymore. People are adding this to their name and to their faces, and they are proud of it. And I think this is the point where we see there is no deja vu, because if we take the 2000 Intifada and this notion that things are repeating itself, social media wasn't there back then. And now we can see the mass, the crowds, the hatred piling up in social media, and not only social media. If we focus on media itself and the religion part of the media, only today one of the local outlets, which is religious a media outlet, just took the word abomination out of the report of the gay pride victim, saying that if the parents would look in Google, it would be inappropriate for them to see the word abomination next to their child. But they do believe this is an abomination. And the media and social media gives so much stage to these words of hatred. And this is a different debate, the freedom of speech and this freedom of hatred and violence.
Yes, exactly. I think what's changed is that racism is not something to be ashamed of anymore. It's somehow become something that is part of being a patriot. You're seen as a patriot if you're more racist. And this is only, to pick up on Shachar's point from before, this is only another variation. The rift between Arabs and Jews is another variation of the rift between left and right, which is becoming more and more extreme within Israeli society. Left and right are defining themselves by ostracizing the other side.
And we are always talking about the limits of democracy. We're always talking about, should a democracy be limited when it gets to this point, when it gets to racism, when it gets to people are losing their shame and not being ashamed of being racist?
It's you know, it's a very interesting challenge because I think you're very right that the problem is magnified by the presence of social media and the internet. These are discussions or discourse, you know, that would maybe happen behind closed doors in the past. You'd have all sorts of racist comments made in family dinners in certain contexts. Now they're made in a somewhat public context, and you see very unhealthy elements within your own society. This is not only an Israeli problem, but with the challenges that this society faces and the amount of racial tension, ethnic tension, the different groups that exist in a very small area, you see a discourse that is not healthy. But the question is, can you prevent it? Can the government do anything, both on a technological and a legal level, to prevent this kind of discourse from getting out of hand? I'm not sure. I'm not sure you can go and say, well, don't say those things on the internet. That has all sorts of ramifications in the other direction.
I just, before we're finishing, I want to ask you, are you optimistic?
I actually am not. I still believe it's a vocal minority, but I think it's very vocal, and those who are left-wing feel that they would be called traitors just because they are left, and those who are right-winged believe they are patriots, and that's why they will become more vocal and less liberal. And I feel like we're going less and less liberal in the region. Entirely.
Well, I practice a more safe kind of optimism. I think it will get better, but unfortunately, I think we have to learn, and it will get worse before it gets better, unfortunately.
Unfortunately, I would say that, you know, it often it's ignored. Nobody ever promised us peace or security or any of these good things. It's really written nowhere that these are defined as the ultimate determinist goal or destination. We cannot assume that that is the eventual outcome. We have to do our best, no matter what, to try and improve the lives of all sides involved here. But we cannot count on any sort of determinist outcome, though.
I-24 News correspondent, thank you very, very much for having this conversation with me. And we should continue doing the job. You should continue doing the job that you're doing, because you're doing an amazing job. Thank you very, very much. No problem. Thank you for this.